So, good afternoon, and thank you for being here for my presentation today. By way of introduction, my name is Megan Grady Rutledge. I am an Academic Technology Specialist at Butler University Center for Academic Technology, which is a division of Butler University Libraries. For those of you who don't follow basketball and may not be familiar with Butler, we are a small liberal arts, high-touch university in Indianapolis, Indiana, boasting student enrollment about 5,000 plus spread across 6 schools of study. As you might have gleaned from my presentation title, I'm here today to tell you about the details of a reading circle that I spearheaded launch of in spring 2018. So yes, very recent. But before I do that, I want to kind of go into a little bit about the nature of my job and what aspects of my job really prompted creation of this reading circle and why we wanted to do it. So when we say why a DH reading circle, the kind of clean, tidy, presentation-worthy answer to that would be because we wanted to promote interest in digital pedagogy projects and to strengthen Butler's internal support community around DH-related work. Now, I know I've used digital humanities twice now and haven't defined it yet. There's a reason for that. If any of you who have been in the definitional genre of digital humanities knows that it is bursting to full with definitions. For the purposes of this reading circle and the purposes of this presentation, I'm referring to digital humanities as simply using technology, and I was going to write this, but never mind, using technology to support teaching and scholarship in the humanities. And I know, again, that there are some gatekeepers of the definition who would bristle at that, but no matter, let them bristle. I'm okay with that. I'm of the opinion that digital humanities needs to be as, malleable and ever-changing as the very landscape on which it was founded. So that's the idea there, and that's very much the idea of the authors of the book that I chose, which we'll talk about in a moment. So the long answer, when I put it to myself, sounds a bit like Charlie Brown, right? The wah, wah, wah. But actually, the long answer to why we thought this would be a good idea at Butler is that as an academic technology specialist, I am frequently called upon to provide technical and pedagogical support for digital projects that faculty assign in their classes. Now, depending on what the faculty want to accomplish and what the learning objective is, my support can entail teaching anything from the tools and best practices surrounding podcasting to infographics to video editing to digital mapping projects and so on. There's a lot that we teach in those classes. And also, it's not just me doing it in a vacuum. I have to coordinate this instruction with librarians because they are essential to this effort. When we're talking about doing digital projects, who better than librarians to teach students about finding, using, and authoring digital tools in accordance with copyright law? Also, when students are in that creative mode, putting things out for public consumption, they need to think about how authority is constructed and contextualized. That's also very, very important. So that's kind of the broad spectrum of what I do, and I know that's a lot to shoehorn into one slide. But when talking about that, what we noticed, the librarians and I both noticed this, in the fall of 2017, we saw a significant increase in the number of faculty requests for this type of support in their classrooms, librarian and technology specialists, particularly from professors teaching in the humanities. And our first reaction to this was to be so over the moon excited because we love partnering with faculty and students in this way. This is why we do what we do. But the other part of us said, whoa, 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 back up the truck, beep, beep, beep. What's going to happen if we continue to see this increase? Will we be able to provide faculty with the levels of support they've come to expect from us? So we thought we really need to meet with faculty yesterday and have a sustained conversation with them about what types of digital pedagogy projects they want to do, what that technology will look like, so that we can start being proactive and building capacity around those projects as opposed to being reactive to it. But also, we wanted something that would also build capacity for faculty who maybe participated in this reading circle and for the librarians who participated as well. Enter in this book. Have any of you heard of this book, Using Digital Humanities in the Classroom? I have kind of a silly picture there with it right now. But this came out in 2017, and it's from Claire Battershill of Simon Fraser and Shauna Ross of Texas A&M. It is very much a rubber meets road, practical introduction to implementing digital pedagogy projects in the humanities classroom. And it's wonderful. It is both broad and deep. And when I say broad, it goes into the kind of the definitional debates around digital humanities and also addresses, you know, the value pedagogically of these types of digital projects. So that can fuel a lot of rich discussion around why faculty want to do these projects. So it's excellent in that way, but it also could act as a roadmap for someone who's new to doing digital pedagogy in the classroom. Some of the chapter titles could shepherd someone through the process of first finding and creating digital resources, ensuring accessibility, designing classroom activities, rubrics, finding internal support, managing those activities, very much as a roadmap for implementation as well as a generator of conversation, which made it great for our reading circle and what we wanted to accomplish. And bonus, it comes with a great web companion that is designed in Scalar, which is part of the University of Southern California and the Alliance of Visual Networking Cultures grant initiative to create a kind of content-rich web space that operates under the metaphor of a book. So with each chapter of this book, there is a corresponding chapter in the web companion that offers links to all sorts of tools and resources for stepping up your digital humanities game. But also, it offers what I found most valuable, examples of student work so that faculty could actually, we didn't talk about it abstractly, we could actually pull up examples of student work beyond Butler and see what was happening out there in this landscape and see if it was something we were interested in. So many samples of student work that you could look at. And again, these have a humanities focus. And also, it provides assignment sets. And with each assignment set, you get a sample prompt that is Creative Commons share-alike license, so you're able to modify it for your purposes. The prompts are very thoughtful. And they come with rubrics, which that was a real challenge when I was providing pedagogical support for digital pedagogy projects, because a lot of faculty didn't have rubrics for these digital projects and needed help with that. So this gives a nice starting place for that, very thoughtfully done. So those were some benefits of the book that we chose. So once the book was there, we really had to look and say, okay, what will this reading circle look like in terms of participation? And because I was spearheading the launch of it, I really had to say, I need a faculty member to help me lead this, because first, I want to attract faculty. It's really important. And I need a faculty member's perspective when I'm putting together the larger goals of this group. So James McGrath, who's our faculty director of core curriculum at Butler and the Clarence L. Goodwin Chair in New Testament Language and Literature, he is such a friend to the Center for Academic Technology. He comes to all of our events. He's a great supporter. So he was absolutely interested in being part of this group. So he was one of my co-facilitators. And then also, the librarian. It was very important that we had librarian representation in the leadership of this group. So Amanda Starkle, who partners with me to co-supervise a student employee program called Information Commons at Butler, we presented here last year on that, she was also a leader of the group. And what I also liked about this organizational structure or this leadership structure is that it really represented the key players in a classroom situation for supporting digital projects, because a lot of times it involves a collaboration, at least at Butler, among faculty, librarians, and academic technology specialists. It takes all of us to make these projects the best that they can be. So what we did, once we had the leadership and facilitation down, when the spring semester started in mid-January, we put out about four calls for participation over a two-week period. So from about January 15th to January 31st, we said, here is what we're doing, here's who's leading it, here are the goals we'd like to accomplish, please join us. And in my experience as an academic technology specialist, do I have any fellow technology specialists in the room? usually when I do things like this, I might get like 3 or 4 people who are interested in it. And so, but this wasn't the case here. As soon as we put out the prompt, which is on available if you want to read it on Butler's website, just butler.edu, just type in digital pedagogies. And the whole reading circle prompt is there with information. We had 19 people express interest. One of them dropped off before the group actually started. This was so huge to me and so exciting. And with that, those 19 people who expressed interest, 9 of them were faculty members. 4 of them were representing the English department, which makes sense because digital humanities, kind of the canonical origin story, goes back to the English departments, but we had someone representing literature, ret comp, literary criticism in the English department. We had a political science professor. We had a history professor who does a lot of counter-hegemonic digital work with our students, with oral history projects. We had a business professor too, which I thought was great. And so it was a really diverse group of faculty. Well, not as diverse with English people, but it was a great group of faculty who were really committed to using digital pedagogy in their classrooms. We had faculty librarians. So at Butler, we have 2 types of librarians. We have staff librarians and we have faculty librarians. So the faculty librarians who participated represented special collections and also instructional librarians. And 5 staff members, including me, and then we had a metadata specialist who's really good with Omeka, who participated, someone who provides digital scholarship support for a digital scholarship librarian who's also part of the group, and then a student. So when I say student, when we put out the call for participation, we did not ask students to participate. This kind of just evolved because I supervise a student in play program. I have a student who has aspirations of becoming a librarian and she wants to focus in digital humanities. So she pulled me aside one day and said, "Megan, may I please participate in this group?" And who was I to look her in the eyes and say, "No, Lydia, I deny you this opportunity for your learning and development. Sorry." So, and actually too, I needed her help. So it ended up working out really well. She helped me with some research that we did for the group. So this was our group membership, 18 people. Not all of them had schedules that would work together. So we ended up running 2 groups, a Wednesday group and a Thursday group. And that's actually probably better anyway, because 18 people for a reading circle, that becomes kind of like an oblate spheroid more than, I don't know, a weird circle. So when we're looking at that, we really just did the 2 groups. Each group met 5 times over the course of the semester. And we met and really dug into some different aspects of the book, looked at examples of student work, pulled out the rubrics, and did some other interesting activities, which I'll talk about here briefly. So that is the participant breakdown. And so our reading circle goals that James and I, the faculty leader, kind of volleyed back and forth before launching the reading circle were things that the group members also agreed to once we got to talking about them. So the first one here is to support the ongoing exploration and creative employment of digital pedagogies in the humanities. And I can say anecdotally that yes, this was happening. There were things we were talking about in the group, like textual analysis, like Vengage type tools that faculty were implementing in their classrooms that day. Really easy, low threshold tools that they were able to use. So I would say that this was absolutely successful in this regard. We wanted to take inventory of digital pedagogy projects at peer and aspirant universities because, you know, people are competitive. We like to see what other institutions are doing. So this is where Lydia really helped me because Lydia came in and did this research for me. I got a list of our peer and aspirant institutions from the provost office, and she went in and did the research. So this research was all done by the student. I put this in a Moodle organization. Everyone in the group was part of this Moodle organization and has editing access, so they're able to go in and add things or comment on things. So all group members have editing access to this. And so that way faculty were able to explore some of the different digital humanities type pedagogy projects happening at our peer and aspirant universities. Also on this Moodle organization, there are resources specific to Butler University about copyright fair use, DH training resources, all sorts of things that after the group ended, people could go back and look at. And we want to continue momentum with this group even after the reading circle is over. So that is something that Lydia really helped me with, the student. We wanted to examine the scholarly and pedagogical affordances of digital authoring design tools. And I think as the emphasis in this group was pedagogy more so than it was scholarship, it doesn't mean we didn't have the scholarship discussion. Because many of the things we were discussing, faculty could use just as well as students. So for example, we looked at digital mapping. And some of the English faculty, I think, then became interested in using digital mapping to enhance maybe some literature paper that they had written that had like a strong spatial like narrative to it. So to create kind of a digital accompaniment to scholarship. So thinking about how faculty could use these tools as well. And then moving forward to some of the other goals we had, vetting rubrics for digital media projects and discussing how and if the evaluative criteria correspond to our university learning outcomes and what faculty want to accomplish. So what was nice about this book, as I mentioned in the web companion, which is freely available, by the way, if I didn't say this, you don't have to have the book to access the web companion. It is teachdh.com, and it contains free rubric examples. So we were able to pull some of those rubric examples, look at the evaluated criteria, and compare them against our student learning outcomes, which was really, really nice. But also an exercise that we did, and I really recommend this exercise because we had a lot of rich discussion around it, is that we took the idea of digital pedagogy just in general, and we took the student learning outcomes as approved by Faculty Senate in 2016, and we went through each one. And we said, does digital pedagogy correspond to this outcome? And that was a really good exercise, particularly for maybe faculty who weren't quite sure they wanted to do these things yet. It really gave them a chance to check in internally and say, is this something that I think is good for my students and the subjects they're learning? And then consider digital humanities projects as avenues for student-faculty collaborative research and cross-curricular scholarship. This was actually interesting because I got to share a personal story. I'm an adjunct in global and historical studies at Butler as well. And in the fall of 2017, my students created digital stories to help highlight the lives of women historically elided for various reasons. And my students and I worked together, and two of them presented at the undergraduate research conference on their digital pedagogy projects in the class and how they helped them understand course content. So it's giving these, you know, students who are majoring in things that don't have a lot of empirical research attached to them, it's giving them opportunities to present at research conferences about how digital pedagogy corresponds to their, you know, learning experience and what that looks like. So, and then the last one, identify training needs and funding opportunities for faculty interested in launching digital pedagogy projects. Now that I have a sense of what our faculty are interested in, this is a lot of what I'll be doing this summer. I'll be doing a lot of research to look at grants and what's available. So if anyone has ideas, feel free to let me know. So some challenges that we had some inconsistent attendance, and this is understandable. We had a lot of people in our groups who were very busy, and some of them at the outset, I need to participate selectively, which is fine because the chapters of this book are self-contained. You don't have to have read everything to be able to join in a group conversation. So I think we had one faculty member who could attend like two of the five sessions. And that was okay. As long as it was okay with the rest of the group, it was okay with me, because again, you didn't have to be privy to the former previous conversations to understand what was happening in the group. The two-group model was kind of challenging, more so from a facilitator standpoint, because it demanded that the facilitators were there 10 times as opposed to the five. But I also really liked it because the groups, interestingly enough, had very different conversations, which was exciting for me. So also part of my job became relaying what the other groups were interested in to the other groups. So facilitating that conversation across groups and within groups became part of it. And then this is where I am right now, deciding on a way forward. I'm still getting feedback from faculty about this. I mean, it just ended basically a couple weeks ago. So deciding on a way forward and what we can do to continue this momentum and keep this group together. And that's exciting and challenging. At this point, I would open it up for questions. Yes.
One, not to overdetermine your student, but she was kind of a hybrid, I guess, perspective as a prospective professional and a student.
Yes.
What was her experience and sort of feedback in terms of the discussion and the actual book?
Yeah. So Lydia is wonderful. She read the book in one night. Once I said she could participate, she was really excited. I mean, so it was really
the cool. Average Butler student.
Right, that is. I mean, that's really the Butler student. There are a lot of really great students at Butler, and so she really enjoyed it. She enjoyed doing the research, and I think knowing that she wants to go on and become a librarian, I think she's leaning toward the digital scholarship thing a little bit more and the digital humanities, because that's been the career track for librarians who are interested in digital humanities. So I think it was really good for her, and the faculty really loved when Lydia was able to attend. She couldn't attend all the sessions, she just attended like two or three during the five that the faculty were in, because they wanted to hear from students about, can you reflect on your digital pedagogy experiences for us and let us know what you got out of them, what you wanted from them that maybe you didn't get. So I think she felt really valued in that context, and it was so nice to be able to, you know, help her learn and grow in that way. So hopefully that answers your question.
Well, it was more along the lines of, you know, maybe what had her experiences been with digital technologies in the classroom, and then if she was sort of a proxy for a student, what excited her more or less in regard, you know, from a student perspective,
sure,
in regard to the conversations.
Yeah, no, that makes sense.
Book.
So she hadn't had a lot of experience in digital pedagogy. She's a professional writing major with a minor in classics Latin. So she hadn't had a lot, but she had done some things in a professional writing class, like building social media content, doing different things like that. So she had definite ideas about things that she needed now that she was looking for jobs, because she's doing a gap year, that maybe she didn't have. So that was nice to hear.
They do the digital humanities and digital pedagogy here, and I'm still trying to figure out all the ways that means.
Yeah.
But I work with pre-service teachers or people who are interested in education, and the website companion with that book, do you think it is something that I could use in my classroom with my students as they're thinking about the ways that they want to teach and what to use digital pedagogy?
Absolutely. It is such a great resource. I even told faculty who didn't have maybe time to read this, just read the corresponding chapter in the web companion, because it will give you the basic overview, but the links that it goes out to. And I mean, if you're teaching teachers how to teach,
yeah,
it has the examples of good assignment prompts for digital pedagogy projects and rubrics.
Yeah.
So it's great, great resource. I recommend it to everyone.
We actually had in my college a group of students who asked, you know, we're interested in digital humanities, we want to have a meeting. In fact, we just had a first meeting a couple of weeks ago. So this reading circle is a good idea, and I think it shows that the students, I think a lot of the students were students who've been involved in special DH projects because they're those kinds of students,
yes,
and they take advantage of opportunities. So moving forward, I'm just wondering if you're envisioning like trying to keep the same group together and read different things each year, or to use this book again and just keep offering it and bring more and more people forward.
So I'm thinking the latter right now. You know, just kind of selfishly too, because that's efficient for me right now in terms of workload, but also because there were people who were interested and maybe didn't get to participate. And I think in looking back, I might want to include more students this time around, maybe not just one student, but we have students who are interested in things like hashtag scholars, digital humanities. This gives them a great opportunity to be part of something and to feel good, to feel like they're partnering with faculty and staff to really help the university. So I'm thinking maybe just to kind of recycle the model, tweak it, recycle and tweak for next fall, and then from that maybe think about how we can continue this momentum and bring the different groups together.
Well, especially you're talking about prospective educators, like that's a great group to reach.
Yeah. So like I mentioned, if you go to butler.edu, the prompt that we used for our group is available there with all the objectives and information. Feel free to take and use whatever you want or to not. I probably spent too much time dwelling on the definition genre. because I felt like I had to tell people, I'm not defining digital humanities, we're having this conversation. Because there's some sensitivity around the definition. But also, if anyone wants the reading circle schedules that we use, like which chapters we decided to focus on, and I didn't put this on my presentation, but I will upload this as well. Let me just type in my email address. So mmgrady@butler.edu, and I'd be happy to share any of the materials. I could also probably even add you as an observer to the Moodle organization if you wanted to look at some of the resources there.
Thank you.
Thank you.